Good morning, students. Last video, we were discussed the modeling of EDLC types, that is linear or waterfall model, iterative or incremental or fountain model, phototyping or evolutionary model, and spiral model. In this video, we will see the remaining topics. This slide shows the fundamental issues in hardware software co-design. The hardware software co-design is a problem statement that causes plenty of problems in the design. The following are some of the basic problems in hardware software co-design. The first one is selecting the model. Second, selecting the model. That is, models are used to capture and describe device characteristics during hardware software co-design. A model is a formal structure made up of objects and rules for how they should be put together, making a decision on which model to use in a device design is difficult. When the design moves to the implementation phase, the designer must turn to a model capable of capturing the system's structure. Then second one is selecting the architecture. A model just collects device features and does not include detail on the system's manufacturing. The architecture defines how a design can be implemented in terms of number and types of modules used as well as their interconnection. Commonly used architectures of device design include controller architecture, data path architecture, complex instruction set computing, that is CISC, reduced instruction set computing, that is RISC, very long instruction word computing, that is VLIW, single instruction multiple data, that is SIMD, multiple instruction multiple data, that is MIMD, and so on. And third one, that is controller architecture. The controller architecture employs a state register, and two combinational circuits to execute the finite state machine concept. The current state is stored in the state register, and the logic for the next state and output is implemented by the combinational circuits. Finite state machine holds the present state. Combinational circuit gives the next state and output. The fourth one is data path architecture. The data path architecture is well suited for applying the data flow graph model, in which the output is generated as a result of a series of predefined computations performed on the input data. A data path is a channel between input and output in data path architecture, and it can contain registers, counters, register directories, memories, and ports, as well as high speed arithmetic units. The data path is linked to multiple buses via ports. The fifth one, finite state machine data path, that is FSM. FSMD. FSMD architecture combines the controller and data path architectures. It creates a controller with a data path. The control input is generated by the controller while the data is processed by the data path. The data path has two types of I/O ports. One serves as the control port, receiving or transmitting control signals from or to the controller device, and the second I/O port connects the data path to the outside world for data input and output. Normally, the data path is implemented in a computer, and the chip I/O pins serve as data input and output ports for the chip resident data path. The sixth one, complex instruction set computing, that is CISC. A complex operation is described by an instruction set in the CISC architecture. A CISC instruction set can perform a large complex operation with a single instruction. The use of CISC instruction instead of several simple instructions decreases program memory access and program memory size requirements significantly. However, additional silicon is needed to implement a microcode decoder for decoding the CISC instruction. Then, 7th one, very long instruction word, VLIW. VLIW architecture implements multiple functional units, that is, it contains ALU, multipliers, etc. in the data path. So, the VLIW instruction captures one basic instruction per functional unit of the data path. The 8th one, parallel processing architecture. Parallel processing architecture employs multiple concurrent processing element. Okay, that is PE, processing element, that is a PE, with each processing element having its own data path containing registers and local memory. Parallel computing architecture include single instruction, multiple data, that is SIMD, and multiple instruction, multiple data, that is MIMD architecture. With the aid of the computing components, a single instruction is executed in parallel in SIMD architecture. A single controller manages the scheduling of the instruction, execution and supervision of each PE. The SIMD architecture serves as the foundation for reconfigurable processor. The 9th one, selecting the language. A programming language captures and maps a computational model into architecture. There is no hard and fast law stating that this language must be used to capture this model. Multiple programming languages such as C, C++, C hash, Java and others can be used to catch a model for software implementations and languages such as VHDL system, VHDL, System C and Verilog for hardware implementations. The CISC processor data path is complex. A single language, on the other hand, can capture a wide range of models. Certain programming languages excel at capturing a specific computational model. For example, C++ is an excellent choice for capturing an object-oriented model. The 10th one is partitioning system requirement into hardware and software. Partitioning may be used to enforce device specification in either hardware or software. It is a difficult decision to make. Various hardware-software trade-offs are used to make a decision on hardware-software partitioning. The next slide shows the computational models in embedded design. The most widely used computational models in embedded system design are the data flow graph, that is DFG model, the state machine model, concurrent model, sequential program model, the object oriented model and so on. Let's see the first one, data flow graph. So this is the first computational model in embedded system. So the DFG model convert the data processing requirements into a data flow graph. The DFG model is also known as diagram model. A DFG model is a guided model in which data determines a program execution. This model focuses on data and data operations that convert input data to output data. Indeed, DFG is a visual model in which data operations are expressed by blocks and data flow is represented by arrows. In DFG notation, an inward arrow to the processor represents input data and an outward arrow from the processor represents the output data. The DFG model is used to model embedded applications that are computationally intensive and data oriented. DSP applications are common examples. In our application, one of the functions include the computational requirement, that is x equal to a plus b and y equal to x minus c. See the diagram, the application of DFG model to meet these requirements. A data path is the data flow path from input to output in DFG model. In a DFG model, does not have multiple values for the input variable and multiple output values for a given set of inputs. It is said to be a cyclic DFG, that is ADFG. A cyclic input provide feedback activities and so on. The software is translated as a single sequential process execution by a DFG model. Okay, see here. So this is first node. Here A plus B are added. The output is X. The X is the input of the second node. Another input is C. Here minus symbol. So X minus C, we get Y. Okay, so this is called data flow graph model. The next one, control data flow graph. Okay, control data flow graph. The DFG model is a data driven model in which the execution is managed by data and no other operation are performed. The control DFG model is used to simulate applications that involve conditional program execution. Okay, CDFG, that is a control data flow graph model, have both data and control applications. The CDFG employs DFG as a decision maker and a conditional as an aspect. CDFG includes data flow nodes as well as decision nodes, while DFG only contains data flow nodes. See the requirements. If flag is equal to 1, okay, see, if flag is equal to 1, x equal to a plus b, otherwise y equal to a minus b. The requirement involves a decision making procedure. See the diagram, CDFG model for the example implementation. In a typical flow chart based design, the control node is defined by a diamond block, which is decision making function. CDFG converts the requirement, which is modeled, into a concurrent process model. The control node decides which process to run. Suppose flag value is equal to 1, that value will be true means add the values, that is a plus b. Okay, so that output is connected to the last. Okay. That output is send it to the peripheral devices or user. Okay, suppose a false means, then here the inputs are a minus b. Okay, that is a minus b. So that value send it to the peripheral devices or send it to the user. So this is called control data flow graph. Then the next slide shows the state machine model, that is FSM model. State machine model is used to simulate reactive or event driven embedded system whose processing behavior is influenced by state transformations.
Typical examples of event-driven system include embedded system found in control and industrial application with the states, events, actions, and transitions. The state machine model defines the system behavior. The term state refers to an existing state of affairs. An occurrence is a piece of information that is fed into the state. The case serves as a catalyst for the state change. The passage from one state to another is referred to as a transition. An action is a task that the state machine must complete. A finite state machine model is one with a finite number of states. To put it another way, the structure is defined using a limited number of potential states. Consider the implementation of an embedded device for driver or passenger seatbelt alerts in an automobile using FSM model as an example. The framework specifications are written like that. When the car ignition is switched on and the seat belt is not fastened within 10 seconds of the ignition being turned on, the device emits a 5-second warning alert. The alarm is switched off until the alarm timer stops. The driver or passenger fasten their seat belt, or the ignition key is turned off, whichever occurs first. Alarm off, waiting, and alarm on are the conditions, and the incident are ignition key on, ignition key off, timer expire, alarm timer expire, and seat belt on. The device specification can be modeled using FSM as shown here. The ignition key on event starts a 10 second timer and changes the condition to waiting. If a seat belt on, if a seat belt is on or ignition key is off, this happens during the wait state. The vehicle enters the alarm off mode. When the wait timer expires in the waiting state, the event time expire is generated and the state is changed from the waiting to alarm on. The alarm on condition persists until a seat belt on or ignition key off. Ignition key off event or alarm time expire event happens, whichever comes first. The presence of each of these occurrence causes the state to change to alarm off. A timer is used to execute the wait condition. In addition, the timer has a number of states and events for state transition. The next slide shows the FSM model for timer. Here, according to the FSM model, the timer state may be idle, ready, or running. The timer is said to be idle state when it is not running during regular operation. When the timer is filled with the count corresponding to the appropriate time delay, it is said to be in the ready state. When the start timer event happens, the timer stays in the ready state. When a start timer event is received, the timer changes its status from ready to running and stays in running state until the timer count ends or a stop timer event happens. When a stop timer or a timer expires, event occurs. The timer status switches from running to idle state. Okay, so this is the example for timer, FSM model for timer. The next one, the next method, that is a sequential program model. The function or computing specifications are performed sequentially in the sequential programming model. that is the same as traditional procedure programming. The program instructions are iterated and conditionally executed here, and the data is converted into a sequence of operation. FSM are a good alternative for designing sequential programs. Flowchart are another useful tool for developing linear programs. FSM method describes the start, event, transformations and behavior, while the flowchart model represents the execution flow. The flowchart approach for modeling the seat belt warning system described in the FSM modeling is shown here. That is the first start the program.
Okay, start the program, then check the status of ignition. Ignition key is on, then wait for 10 seconds. Check the ignition status, whether on state or off state. Till on state means check the seat belt status, that is a seat belt on or off. If there is a no seat belt wearing means set the timer for 5 seconds start alarm. Once again check the ignition key status. Again ignition status on. Again check the seat belt on. If it is a yes means stop the alarm. Suppose no means time expired. Okay, time expired, then stop the then time expired. So again it moves to here, that is again check the ignition status, again check the seat belt condition. If seat belt is weird means then stop the alarm, then it moves to the end process. Okay, suppose here ignition key is off, that means it directly moves to the end condition. Okay, suppose ignition key is on, then only it moves to the next step, that is check the seat belt condition for 5 minutes. After 5 minutes it start alarm warning. Then once again check the ignition status and seat belt status. Ignition off means then directly moves to the end, otherwise check the seat belt. Suppose if seat belt is yes means stop the alarm, no means time expired. Once again the same loop will continue till the seat belt is wearing. Okay, so this is about a sequential program model for seat belt warning system. The next one, concurrent or communicating process model. The concurrent or interacting process model which execute task or process at the same time. Certain specification can be implemented faster in the concurrent processing model than in the traditional sequential execution model, where the task requires one or zero waiting state, sleeping for a given time and so on. Sequential execution result in a single sequential execution of the task, resulting in low processor usage. When a task is divided into several subtasks, it is possible to efficiently manage CPU used by swapping the task execution when the subtask under execution enters a wait or sleep state. The concurrent processing model, on the other hand, necessitates additional overhead in task scheduling, task synchronization and communication. The seatbelt warning system is seen in the example of the concurrent processing model. It has the ability to divide task into timer task for waiting 10 seconds, task for checking the ignition key status, task for checking the seat belt status, task for starting and stopping the alarm, then alarm timer, task for waiting 5 seconds. The above task cannot be executed in a random or sequential order. It is necessary to synchronize their execution through some mechanism. The warning can be achieved immediately after the 10-second delay period has expired and only if the seat belt is unfastened and the ignition key is turned on. As a result, the warning monitoring role is only performed until the wait timer expires and the ignition key is in on position and the seat belt is in off position. It can be incident to signify both situations. So the wait timer expires event is linked to the timer job event and it is initially reset before being set until the timer expires. Similarly, the task ignition on and ignition off are associated with the event ignition on and off, and the task seatbelt on and off are associated with the mission seatbelt status warning. The ignition key status tracking task set and reset the event ignition off and ignition on. When the ignition key status is off and reset the when the ignition key status is on. The seatbelt status tracking task also set and reset the incidents seatbelt off and seatbelt on when the seatbelt status is off and when the seatbelt status is on. The alarm timer job is aligned with the activities. Alarm timer start and alarm timer expire. And the alarm timer will start in the reset state at first and it is set by the alarm control task when the alarm is triggered. The alarm timer expire event is initially reset and it is set until the alarm timer expires. The alarm monitoring role waits for event wait timer to expire before starting the alarm timer and alarm if all the events ignition on and seat belt off are in the fixed state when the event wait timer expires. If not, the warning monitoring mission simply finishes its execution and exits. If the warning is activated, the alarm monitoring task wait for either of the following events to occur. The alarm timer expiring, the ignition being turned off or the seat belt being activated. When either of these events occurs, the alarm is silenced and the alarm monitoring task simply finishes its execution and returns. So this is about concurrent or communicating process model. Then the last one is object-oriented model. The object-oriented architecture is an object-based model that is used to modeling device specifications. It breaks down a complex software requirement into simple, well-defined bits known as objects. The object-oriented model improves device architecture, reusability, maintainability, and efficiency. In object-oriented modeling, an object is an entity used to describe or model a certain piece of the structure. Each entity has a distinct set of behaviors and states. A class is an abstract overview of a collection of objects that can be thought of as an object's blueprint. A class defines an object state via member variables and object behavior via member functions. A class member variable and member function may be private, public or protected. Private member variables and functions are only available within the class, while public variables and functions are not accessible from the outside the class. Groups originating from a parent class, on the other hand, have access to the safe member functions and variables. The concept of the entity and class include abstraction, hiding, and security. So, this is called object oriented model. See here, the first one is requirement definition, then it moves to object oriented analysis, it moves to object oriented design, then after that reusability survey of component library, then it moves to availability of components in library. If yes means system construction, then moves to system test, then customer evaluation. Suppose customer accepted means installation and conversion, then operation and maintenance. Okay, so this is one way of flow for object oriented model. Another way, suppose if the components are not available in the library means, then collect the requirement that is a requirement definition, then analysis and design, then write the coding for this, then components are test. Okay, so these are all included in the library, that is a components library. Once again check the library. If it is yes means the same procedure. Okay, suppose here customer evaluation is not accepted means, once again check the object oriented analysis or change the object oriented analysis. Otherwise check the object oriented design or change the object oriented design and follow the same procedure. Okay, so this is about object oriented model. So far we have covered the fundamental issues in hardware software co-design, computational model in embedded design under this data flow graph, control data flow graph, finite state machine model, sequential program model, concurrent or communicating process model, and object oriented model. We will meet in the next video. Thank you.